Well, I'm going to defend a more aggressive theory than I maybe actually believe, just to be provocative, and say that the most visual art, the most non-linguistic glories of human culture are all actually dependent on, even parasitic on, language. That if it weren't for the words that are behind all cultural transmission in our species, we couldn't have non-verbal cultural transmission in a big way. But first, let's look at some other. It's not that words aren't the only sort of digital means. I talked a little bit in Breaking the Spell about some, as it were, mimetic inventions of human culture, which are sort of independent of language. If you look around the world and you look at dance, you find, well, first of all, how many of you know what lava notation is? Lava notation was the attempt by a French choreographer, I think in the early 20th century, to come up with something like musical notation for dance. So it was an attempt to create a score so that a choreographer could write a score, and this would be a way of recording the dance. It was brave and brilliant and wonderful and a complete failure. I remember many years ago I had a student who was a dancer who wanted to try to invent a better alternative to lava notation. I said, go for it, but I think you'll find it's very difficult. And actually he abandoned the project when I said, look, if you really want to do this right, you should realize how high the standard has to be. In American baseball, the pitchers have many different pitches. There's this curveball and the slider and the knuckleball and the fastball and various, maybe half a dozen different pitches. And of course, the pitchers try to conceal which pitch they're throwing until the last possible instant. But a good trained baseball player or commentator or viewer can see without any difficulty what pitch the pitcher is throwing. And so if you can come up with a notation that can capture that visible difference, then you've really got something. But if you think about it, you realize that's very, very difficult to do. Or just the difference between four or five different signature backhands in tennis or something like that. The space of possible dance moves looks very analog. And so because it looks very analog, it's very hard to digitize. But of course, folk dances, they digitize. Whether it's square dances in America or contra dances, there are a finite set of moves that you learn, and everybody learns them. And that's how the dances are transmitted. And the variations between the individuals sort of wash out. They don't count. There's many different ways of doing the do-si-do or the promenade or something in square dancing. And you can invent local variations on it. But the underlying move is there's a sort of norm of correction. This is how you recognize it. So it's digitized. Now nobody appreciated the rationale of that. Nobody designed that. Evolution designed that. Because the dances that weren't digital couldn't be transmitted. So the fitness of the dance move derives from the digitization process, which makes it transmissible. And, I mean, that's only part of the fitness, of course. So now, we see, now that's not language, but it gives you a digitized base for combinatorial explosion. And creates the groundwork for a tradition that can be transmitted with high fidelity over many generations. Another really nice feature of this is that you get von Neumann multiplexing for free. The reason that our laptops work so super reliably is because at various points they have redundancy, where they have at least three versions of a signal, and they use a majority rule principle to correct errors that arise, because von Neumann realized that you can get indefinitely reliable transmission with indefinitely unreliable elements as long as you put these vote takers in the middle every now and then to absorb the error. That's von Neumann multiplexing. That's why you can have a ritual in a religion. Nobody has to remember it perfectly. Because if they keep performing it, and so the recurrence of the performance is really important, but they have to do it in unison, they have to do it as a group. And that way, anything that you forget, your neighbor will probably remember, and you keep refreshing your memory of the ritual from the majority rule of the participants. So the whole group can keep the ritual constant from year to year to year, in spite of the fact that nobody has a perfect memory of how the ritual is done. Another example of digitization playing a role in cultural transmission. Now, it's very true to say that, and we've moved beyond that. We have high culture now. Glory in the parts of the arts that are not like folk dances, that are not like simple rituals, and we extol the most original and non-rote, non-formulaic aspects of art. But I submit that all of that is parasitic on the underlying capacity of culture to be formulaic, because in formulaic culture is the backbone is the wrong metaphor. It's the formulaic aspects of culture that's the DNA of culture that permits it to build over the generations.
Well, after all, I'm not that generous. I can resist to make a question right now. And I like to order you between, in terms of the question we are discussing here, between two extremes. One, it would be the sociobiology, which says, well, morality is just an illusion. And I think it's too much reductive to biology than it should be. And the other extreme would be people like Pinker, who's, and I almost quote, we can do with language almost everything we want. That would be too much. So we are in the middle of this. We are, of course, animals, and we evolve, but our beginning is exactly the same simple beginning as any other living being on the earth. But it strikes me that the explanation, when it comes to explain how it comes, language plays a very important role. And I think, well, if we think when it started, we start to talk with each other, it was very recently in our history. So what was behind that? Mm-hmm. And we must have been interacting in a very intense way and without words. So I miss the gap. And so I ask you, what would you think could fill this gap? Mm-hmm. My guess is we have to trust more on affections and empathy and things like that. What do you think about
it? Well, first, let me say that I agree with you that sociobiology got us off on a bad start in some ways. Not because there's some brilliant stuff in it, but Ed Wilson's an ant expert. If he were a bird expert, then I think there would have been a lot more, people would have come out being a lot more like birds than they are. He's a sweet guy and he has many wonderful ideas, but he did, his enthusiasm distorted his message. And a lot, but by no means all, or by no means even the bulk of the criticism of sociobiology was deserved. I think, again, a lot of it was hysterical and unfortunate, and the role of some of his colleagues in caricaturing it and ridiculing it was, I think, dishonest and ignoble. And I think that Ed stood up to that ignoble and dishonest attack with great grace and dignity. So I think it's very important to realize that. I think it's simply shocking what his colleagues, what Gould and Lewontin and a few other people did to try to destroy his reputation, and I think it is wonderful that his reputation survives quite handsomely in spite of their really concerted efforts to make him a pariah, which he certainly is not. But I think he overstated the case. And, surprise, surprise, because he did not appreciate the role of human culture in grounding so much of what's important. But you want to say that emotional attachments and bondings, which are pre-linguistic and are in some sense more basic in language, play a big role. And I think that's right. Although, interestingly, it means, in a way, playing back into the hands of sociobiology. It means that there's something they write about. It's part of our animal nature. It's not just the culture. It's part of our animal nature. It's part of our mammalian heritage, or even our vertebrate heritage that we really have to encounter. Well, who has a lot to say about this in the history of philosophy? Well, Hume, who talks about the natural virtues and the artificial virtues. The natural virtues are the ones that we get basically as part of our animal heritage. He didn't quite have Darwin's vision, got very close, but the idea that our emotional attachments to our young and to our family, to our friends were primordial was right there, and he had a good account of it, and he had a good account of how culture that comes in is a a corrected but also an exploiter and an enhancer of those very, those instincts for good. So we have Kant who says, it's amazing that we can make such straight timbers from such gnarled wood, kind of stressing the sort of importance of culture and taming the beast. Then you have others saying, no, we're born good-natured, most recently Franz de Waal, the Dutch primatologist, his book Good Nature, who likes to stress the extent to which there is a sort of proto-morality in chimpanzees. I think Franz de Waal is telling a very, very one-sided story. He tends to downplay and overlook the viciousness that has also been very well recorded among chimpanzees in the wild. They're not as wonderful, as good-natured, as he wants to portray them. Not that he doesn't have his side of the story, and it's a good one. A deeper, I think, implication of the primordiality of emotions lies in the fact that this is what I've been working on the last few years with some of my graduate students. The way in which the computer between the ears, your neck pop, the control system for your neck pop is emotional, everywhere. Emotions and micro-emotions are the control signals that propagate through your brain. And this fundamentally changes the architecture. When you think, if you look at the history of artificial intelligence, you look at the history of computational neuroscience, you see that one of the features that has been routinely imported from computer science, from programming, from the design of hardware, is the idea of hierarchical systems of subroutines with a high level of control, which is in a certain sense dictatorial. I can go way back to a book that fascinated me when I was a beginning graduate student, Miller, Galanter, and Pribram, Plans of the Structure of Behavior, with its famous TOPE units, test, operate, test, exit. Does that mean, this is archaeology of cognitive science here, back in the 60s. So, most of the software that you are familiar with, all of the software that you are familiar with, is organized like an ideal corporation. There's the CEO level and the vice presidential level. And then there are the people down in the basement that take their orders, and they're sort of slaves, and everybody does this job. Reports to his superior, reports to his superior, reports to his superior. And there's nothing like that. Absolutely nothing like that in the brain. The brain is organized from semi-autonomous, often conflicting, anxious, selfish little robots. And there's tremendous waste motion, there's a lot of conflict, there's a lot of competition. And out of all of that political chaos, order, grace, ingenuity, brilliance, reflective capacity, all of that has to emerge from the sort of quasi-political infighting of all of these elements. And that's all the medium in which all of that is negotiated is neuromodulators. This is micro-emotions. This is... The only way I can hold your attention now is by enlisting some of those armies in your head to beat back the competition and pay attention to me rather than all the other things that you could be paying attention to. And you can't, there's no level in your brain which is that I am going to pay attention to this now. You know that, you know, because when you try to do that, it doesn't work. So the level of, I mean, this wonderful vision that we get from Descartes, you know, from philosophers generally, but also from psychologists, of this beautifully organized rational mind, we have to realize that that's a temporary, ephemeral achievement. When everything is going just right and we get all the bickering to stop, we can marshal, the forces can marshal themselves, because there's no I in there that's doing it, to get us to concentrate on a particular task and get it done. And there's no traffic cop in there. There's no king. There's no dictator. There's no CEO that makes it happen. It's an unruly democracy at best. And that's where emotions are really fundamental. And the rationality that we do achieve, and we do, it's a balancing act. It's like a circus performance. You manage to pull it off when everything is going just right.
Thank you. Now we have room for some questions. I will just beg your attention to 2 points. First, to present your questions in a way that everybody in this room can listen to it, including Professor Leonard Natterly. And second, please, to do this as a question, not as a new lecture.